Before we dive into Amazon EKS, let's start with a quick overview of Kubernetes architecture. Kubernetes is a container orchestration platform used for running distributed applications and services at scale. With the help of add-ons, it can automatically scale your workloads and manage the lifecycle of your applications. Usually, you would have a control plane that would consist of multiple nodes for high availability and etcd database cluster where Kubernetes stores all its state. For example, how many replicas of your application needs to be running. It can be deployed separately or stuck together on the same nodes, or even a single node in some development environments. Technically, you can run your applications on the control plane nodes, but most Kubernetes clusters will have dedicated instances, usually called worker nodes or node pools, to run your workloads. Now, Amazon EKS simply abstracts away the control plane from you. It gives you a single endpoint to interact with your Kubernetes cluster. It only lets you manage Kubernetes workers. Since it's AWS service, it's tightly integrated with other AWS services such as AWS Identity Access Management System, Security Groups, and many others. There are multiple ways how you can create EKS cluster. I think by far the simplest one is to use EKSetl. With a single command EKSetl create cluster, you get a fully functional Kubernetes. You can also deploy EKS from the AWS console, but I prefer to use Terraform. If you don't even want to manage Kubernetes workers and focus only on your applications, you can select AWS Fargate. It's the same managed Kubernetes cluster, but AWS will also take care of node pools for you. For me, it's like technical debt. First, it's convenient and easy to get started, but you will face the consequences in the long run. If you have your own data center and want to run EKS on your own hardware, AWS has a solution for you. It's called Amazon EKS Anywhere. Depending on your requirements, you can choose to create either a public EKS cluster. EKS endpoint will be public and nodes may have public IP addresses. Or you can go with a private EKS cluster. The control plane endpoint will be private and all your nodes will have only private IP addresses. You can even disable inbound and outbound internet access. To interact with the cluster, you would create a Bastion host or set up a VPN. At the time of writing, EKS will cost you 10 cents per hour for each Amazon EKS cluster that you create. Also, you will pay for EC2 instances that EKS uses as workers and a data transfer between availability zones. If you need internet access, AWS will also charge you for the NAT gateway. Now let's talk about Kubernetes nodes. You have two options here. You can go with self-managed instance groups. In that scenario, you would create EC2 autoscaling group based on the open source Kubernetes AMI image provided by AWS. You can even create your own custom AMI images if you have special requirements for the nodes. The downside is that you can't drain the node when you scale in the cluster. Kubernetes will not consider the distribution budget of the applications. Also, you cannot perform automated rolling upgrade of the nodes unless you use specialized tools that can handle it for you. For example, COPS. If you want all of these benefits out of the box, you can use EKS managed instance groups. You can also utilize spot instances for both managed and self-managed instance groups to save a little bit of money. To autoscale nodes, you need to define the minimum and the maximum number of nodes in the autoscaling group. Plus, you must deploy a cluster autoscaler. It will adjust desired capacity based on the load. If you want to run stateful applications in Kubernetes, such as Postgres database, Redis, or anything that requires persistent storage, you can use EBS volumes. Amazon EKS comes with a default storage class. You just need to define the volume claim templates section in your YAML or create a persistent volume claim separately. That default class will only allow connecting a single pod to the EBS volume. It's called read-write-once. If you need to attach multiple pods to the same volume, read-write many, you can use Amazon EFS. This video explains how to deploy EFS provisioner and create a storage class based on the Amazon EFS. If you want the option to increase the volume size after it was attached to the pod, for example, your database ran out of disk space, you can create a similar storage class with the allow volume expansion parameter equal to true. Before you can create EKS cluster in your AWS account, you need to have a VPC, virtual private cloud. You can use existing one or create a new one. There are a few requirements for VPC depending on what type of cluster you want to deploy. You also would need to tag your subnets. For example, to use a specific subnet for public load balancers, you need the following tag: Kubernetes role ELB equal to 1. EKS uses a native VPC network. You don't need to deploy any virtual networks such as Flannel or Calico. All the pods get IP addresses directly from the EC2 instances. Each EC2 instance type has different limitations on how many network interfaces and IP addresses it can have. This will limit how many pods you can deploy per node. For example, C5 large EC2 instance type can only support 29 pods. If you want to create network policies for pods, you need need to deploy the Calico network policy engine. Then you can limit outbound and inbound network access between pods and namespaces. This network policy will only allow inbound access from all pods in the production namespace. Now imagine a different situation. You have Amazon RDS managed by AWS database in your account and you want to allow only the full service to access that database. Network policy won't work here. Instead, you can use security groups for pods to implement that network segmentation. Usually, access to managed services managed via IAM roles, and security groups for pods is just an additional level of security. As with any other Kubernetes clusters, you can use a plain YAML, Helm charts, or any other tool to deploy a workload to EKS. Typically, you would create ECR image repository in your account and upload your images out there. You can share that image with multiple AWS accounts if needed. If you want to automatically scale your workloads based on the load, you can deploy a horizontal pod autoscaler to increase or decrease the number of replicas. You can use custom metrics from Prometheus and not only CPU and memory usage of the pod. If your application cannot be scaled horizontally, you can use a vertical pod autoscaler. It will increase or decrease CPU or memory limits for you. If you wish, you can use it as a recommendation engine without performing any actions. Keep in mind, you can use only one of them at a time, horizontal or vertical pod autoscaler. To expose your application from the Kubernetes to the internet, you can use a simple load balancer or pick the ingress controller such as Nginx. Or you can use the new native Amazon load balancer controller. It replaces in-tree controller to create load balancers when you specify the service of type load balancer. It can also act as a layer 7 load balancer and be used as a typical ingress resource. Suppose you need to grant access to your pod to one of many AWS services, such as Amazon Elastic Cache. You need to define the IAM policy and attach it to the IAM role. Now, the old way is to attach that IAM role directly to the instance group. In that case, all the applications in Kubernetes will get equal access to the same resource. To improve security, AWS created something called IAM roles for service accounts. It allows to control access on the pod level. To monitor EKS, you would typically deploy Prometheus with node exporters, CodeVisors, and other monitoring components. To visualize metrics, you would use open source Grafana. Depending on your priorities, you can use managed services by AWS as well. To collect logs from applications, you would deploy either Fluentd or Fluentbit daemon set and configure it to push logs to CloudWatch, where you can query them. You can even create metrics out of logs. Then everything that your application will write to the console will be scraped by those agents and sent to AWS. You can also replace CloudWatch with other preferred solutions such as Elasticsearch and Kibana. It's up to you and your developers. Some of your workloads will require a password or a token that needs to be securely stored. You can use plain Kubernetes secrets. But if you adopt GitOps, you'd probably want to use sealed secrets that can be safely stored even in public Git repository. You can also use HashiCorp Vault. Now, if you want native AWS integration, you can keep your secrets in AWS Secrets Manager and expose them in your Kubernetes using Store CSI driver. If you need an example, I have a video on how to use it. Those passwords and tokens can be provided to pods as environment variables or files that you can mount directly to pod's file system. I would also recommend you to go through the EKS best practices guide. If you're ready to get started with EKS, you can follow one of my two guides. If you're just getting started, you can use EKS etl, and if you're ready for production use, you should create your EKS cluster using Terraform.